this technical problem. Now with the second keynote speaker, Professor Mustafa Sayyid, a native born Egyptian. He received his bachelor degree at Ayn Shams University in 19-something in Cairo. Then he got his degree, PhD degree from Florida State University in 19-something. We don't want to mention the date exactly, I don't know. After doing his postdoctoral work at Yale and Harvard and Caltech, he joined the faculty of University of UCLA. He's been like chair for Julius Brown chair and adjunct professor at Georgia Tech. So welcome, Professor Mustafa.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You know, cancer is a very, very, well, it and heart attack are the ones that kill half the people in the world. How many of you know somebody, relative or a friend or that has cancer? Would you raise your hand, please? Would you raise your hand if you know somebody that has cancer? It's a very bad disease. Up to now, they have not found that medicine for it to really cure it. Everybody gets it almost. 85% of those that get it, they die of it. So it's one of the biggest enemies probably of human people that we have. You know. Now when the new science came in, you always have to try the new science. Does it help? Does it help? So what I want to let you know today is some of the results of using gold nanoparticles in the shape of a nanorod, superrod, that if you take a solution of it, inject it in the cancer lump, and that the solution goes around and around, the gold nanoparticle mixes everywhere, and then you expose light, near infrared light. near infrared light, yani much weaker than this, this is too strong, and for a few minutes, and then leave it, within 2 weeks, the lump disappears. What happened is the gold nanorod absorbs the near infrared light and heats up, make the whole region where the cancer is hot. And the heat, it doesn't have to be very hot temperature, 45 degrees centigrade, that melts the cancer cells and they get rid of the cancer. So of course that was a nice, nice result, of course. And so we followed this direction, and I'll show you some of the results that we have obtained. I'll give you some of the a little bit of nanotechnology. A lot of you know this, then we'll get to the nanorod after that, and give you the results of what we have seen all along the last few years now. These are different nanoparticles that you, a lot of you, familiar with, and gold and silver turn out to be very useful because of these optical and photothermal properties, but different kinds of nanoparticles have different properties, And they are used in different directions, of course. Okay. If you want to get to bind the gold nanorod to cancer cell, well, a cell has a certain functional groups on the surface. Cancer cell especially has specific different ones. And all that you have to do is to bind the gold nanorod. In one end, you hook it to this peptide, and on the other end, that has the functional group that binds to the functional group on the cancer cells. And you just mix them together, and all the gold nanorods will just bind to the surface of the cancer cell that you want. In most cases, actually, we don't even need to do that. We just mix them together. And we heat the heat solution as a whole. We don't have to be very close to the cancer cell to heat. We just heat the solution around the cancer cell. But this is just a way, if in the beginning when we didn't know if we want to make sure it binds to the cancer cell and so on, you can do these things there. So the gold nanorods have two properties, very important properties when the light hits them. Depends on the size of the nanoparticle. If it is large, it scattered light effectively. It gives you light back 10 times stronger than the light you put in. So you can see cancer cells. So you can use it for detecting cancer. Because you just mix the solution and bind this peptide to it, and it binds to the cancer cell. If the cancer cell is there, you find all the gold nanoparticles on the top of the cancer cell, you know this blood has cancer. So you can detect cancer. You can detect one cancer cell. Second one, if you want to kill it, now that you know that you have it, all what you have to do is use a smaller one that actually, instead of scattering light back to you, it absorbs it and gets hot. Okay? And the heat goes around and the solution itself start killing cancer cells. Okay. Let me show you here some of the results that you have here. Here are different cells. These two cells here are cancer. This cell here is not, it's a healthy cell. And you mix the three of them with the same amount of solution that has this so large gold nanorod that scatters light, and with this peptide. You have to put the peptide here that binds it to the cancer cell, if there is cancer cell there. So you can see the first two are cancer, and indeed, look at all the scattered light coming back. Coming all of it, all the light coming from the cell itself, the top of the cell itself. And this one here does not have cancer, so the nanorod doesn't bind to it. It's in solution everywhere, but not on the cancer cell itself. So you know this blood does not have cancer, this blood, these two types of blood here definitely have cancer. Simply experiment under a biology microscope. This is nothing fancy microscope. One of your biology labs have these microscopes. Okay. Now you can also, you can use it, now this scattering light is very useful because it binds to the cancer cell, and if the cancer cell is moving, you can see the scattered light is moving. So you can actually detect it to determine how good a drug for cancer is. Because as long as the cancer is moving, the cancer cell is moving, you see the scattered light is moving. But once it dies, you see it standing still. So here is the two things here. Let me just show you here and here. So it's not moving. You can see this pattern, and you can take a stopwatch with you and see when does the movement stop, because the first one is already stopped, and that is this pattern, kills the cancer cell immediately, so it stops the movement. This one took much longer, this kind of drug is not as good, but let us do it again, let me see if we can get them back again. Okay. Here we go. And put them at the same time. Now watch this. The cisplatin the cells are moving, but then the drug kills it, it stopped. So this one stopped. So you know how long it took that drug, this amount of drug, to kill cancer cell. The other one is still going. That means this drug really is not very efficient, is not very good for the cancer cell. So determine how good a drug is killing cancer cells. Okay. We try to make more science out of it. You use Raman spectroscopy, and then you can see vibration bands of the cancer cell during its as it dies, and hopefully you understand the mechanism, the molecular mechanism of how does a cancer cell die when you give a drug or by itself. So I'll just show you some of the results without having here, for example, here. Here's this is the Raman spectrum, and take a certain amount of the cancer cells, and we get, when we scatter it, we can see different vibrations around in the cancer cell, and with time, as the cell is going through life, or when it dies, there are changes of molecules. So you see vibrations here, not characteristic of the molecule that you see, that our scattered light coming out shows, okay, in the cancer cell. And you can see here, for example, we give it a drug, so you can see here the vibration spectrum is changing with time, because the cells are alive. But watch from here on, watch right here, from here on the spectrum doesn't change. The spectrum here is like this time. It's 13 hours after we give it the drug, and all the way. So that means at 10 hours, the amount of drug we gave this cell, it died. It took 10 hours for the amount of drug we gave this cancer cell, it died, it killed it. Now, once you understand also these vibrations of death, these are vibrations of dead cells, whereas these are vibrations of alive cells, you can understand hopefully the process of death of a cancer cell. And the sign, what the mechanism, what are the molecules involved in that, and so on. Okay. You can also, of course, detect cancer death from resonance Raman spectroscopy. We do that. Now, we can do this also because we said once the drug kills the cells, the amount of drug you gave to the cells killed it, you can see the spectrum doesn't change as more anymore. So you can add the same amount of different drugs for a certain patient blood that has cancer, and you can tell what is the best drug for this patient. Because, you know, as soon as the spectrum stops changing, it measured the time, it took so long, so the drug that makes took a very short time to kill it, and you see the spectrum become constant, that is the good drug for this patient. So you can even get more involved. But for us, of course, as chemists, we like to understand the mechanism of killing itself. So from the different bands that appear in the Raman spectrum, by different drugs trying to kill it, you can get an understanding that opens the whole field to us to try to understand the mechanism of drugs killing cancer cells. We talk about different drugs, different cancer cells. So this is opening up a whole new field in this area that hopefully will help understanding how does a drug interact with cancer cells. And this itself can get us to understand what is the mechanism of death of cancer cells and what cancer is all about. And hopefully one day we can stop it somehow, hopefully. Now, we did quite a bit of work on that. Then you ask yourself, how about in mice, in animals? Of course, we want to get to do all these things in human, but of course, you can do it cells. Of course, you can do it in human, take blood outside the cell. But if you want to do anything inside a patient, then you've got to do as a drug. You want to use a drug to kill cancer inside the patient. Well, that's a medicine. medicine, you know, it's a long way to get from experiments in the lab and things like this to actually experiment on human. I take a certain drug because I know it kills the cells and I know how it kills it and all these things. But you cannot, for example, how does the photothermal heat kill cancer cells in the body of a human? You cannot use it. You cannot use this method to save a patient unless you prove to the, of course, the health department that there is no long-term effect. You got rid of cancer, but does it say 5 years later you get a worse disease than cancer, or does something else? And so these are the things. Now, to take it to human, you have to do a lot of experiments. I'm sure you all know about this. And so we had to start understanding how does cancer interact with different animals. I mean, we said we killed cancer, we did it in mice before. And then you have to go to human to see if really it does the same thing or not. Well, that's a little bit more, take a long time, and we are really in this time now. We have to do it on many, many animals, and you have to show that does not have other effects. It might kill cancer and produce a worse disease inside the body. So you really have to very much to make sure that it does not have any effects here. So that's what we started, and in the USA, we did the mice. That was easy. You don't have to get permission to do mice. In fact, you don't have permission to do dogs or any animals. You don't have to get permission. But to get it to human, you have to do it to all these animals and show it did not do any much bad effects on it. And then you hope that the FDA in America or to agree to it or not, and so on. So that is what is taking us now the time, the last few several years, to do it on animals and different animals and so on. We were able to do it on mice in the United States. It was a simple proposal and was not expensive at all. And we were able to do it on animals in with the cancer system there, Cancer Society, and at Emory has a very good cancer center. So we wrote a proposal to NIH that we like to do to see if we can cure the cancer of a mice, or many, many mice actually, and to prove that it is useful for the mice. And there is no after effect that you do that. So you can see here we stopped doing, but then it worked beautifully on the mice, really nice. Now we tried in the United States to do it on dogs, you know. And we wrote a proposal, and it's a very, you had to have with you a doctor animal that knows how to handle animals and so on. And she told us, it's going to be very expensive and it's going to take a long time. Why? Because here in America, you don't go to a person bringing you his or her dog and asking you to cure its cancer, and you tell them, can we try a new method? They immediately say, give me the dog, excuse me, I don't want you to touch it. Cancer dogs in America like members of the family, just like their son and daughter. You cannot take it to try something on them. So she said that it will take a long time if you find somebody that will take a chance for science sake and see if it works or not. So it was the NIH itself was so expensive that they couldn't support it. So I gave that kind of seminar in Egypt, almost about 7-8 years ago. And it was written in the paper and things like that. And Mustafa is a very nice organization. He's the head of that, and they collect Zakat, meaningless, and they use it for important things to help these diseases or poor people and so on. So he read it in the paper, so he told the Egyptian health center there, he told them that if you get Professor Kitsai to with you on this, we'll give you all the money you want. So they contact me, they send me the paper that was mentioned, and I said, sure, I'd be glad to, you know, partner. And we have been working with them since then. And then another group, I went to the government, I told them, you know, I feel much happier if you give support of another research group in another organization, at the University of Cairo, actually, at the department there, and they want to do the same thing. But it would be nice if they do the same thing and they got the same results, as long as they don't talk to each other. both of them said, we're not going to talk to each other. We're not going to tell them what we're doing. No, that would be okay. So I was able to get money from the government for this other group, and both of them are doing beautiful work. My God, really incredible. Interesting, it turned out each group were doing slightly different things. They were trying to cure, of course, medicine, but the university people, of course, are more interested in the mechanism, the molecular mechanism of things. The other group, they just want to cure as many animals as possible and get the statistics and so on, but that's what we need. But the other group, at the same time, try to understand what are the molecular mechanisms of curing cancer by certain medicines. So it turned out, they don't know that, but it turned out, independent was extremely useful, actually. So there, these are the story of different. The important thing is, you have to prove to the health department there is no long-term effect. You can cure the cancer now, everything's happy, but say 5-6 years from now, you get another disease we don't even know about, see? So that is what I want to do, long-term results from that. And you can see here, 15-month effect, the different thing here, they show, and then here, 1 month after the treatment, 15 months after the treatment, and you can see similar effects. They said from the people that know the biology of this, they say it looks exactly the same, just getting older, that's all, from here, the kidney here, 15 months, this is 1 month. So they said at least 15 months, there is no 15-month toxicity for this. And they did that for the thermal treatment effect. Here is animal that were treated, and this animal were not treated, and you can see the efficacy, the effect of the treatment is certainly quite different. Here is a very interesting, very impressive result. There was a cat that had a huge cancer here, and one of the interesting things about this is that, I mean, this would never, surgery, you cannot cut all of this. This is huge, half of her body, one third of her body. It's just would have killed the cat immediately, of course. But thank God, after a few treatments, they had to do it several treatments, four or five treatments, and after that, everything went down, and more important that there were some questions that after special breast cancer, whether the ladies get children or not, get pregnant or not. And so that was an interesting experiment they did, and they cured this, and indeed, after a few months, she got pregnant and got three kittens, and you can see they all happy. It had been now about a year and a half, and the cat is nothing came back. It's very, very important. Does it come back or not? It's a very important thing. And after a month and a half, it's dead. She did not come back. But now you have to take long time toxicity measurement, because FDA will not accept 2 months even. They want to take long time toxicity, and that's what they're doing quite a bit in Egypt. As I told you, I don't do this in the States anymore. I come to Cairo, and these two groups are working, and they don't talk to each other, they talk to me, thank God. I know everything they do, and they are really working very, very hard on that. And these are different results. You can see the treatment, the effect of the treatment. They actually discovered a very new, interesting method they found that actually surgery is one of the things that gets the cancer back, actually. So they were able to compare two types of treatment. The old method, doing surgery, cutting the cancer out, and the other one by photothermal, just heated and slowly seeing disappear. And they found out that if they do surgery, straight cutting and so on and so forth, it appears very soon after that. A few months after that, because cancer appears somewhere else and so on. By this method, photothermal method, cancer never appears again. And that is itself is telling us something about cancer, which is a friend who understand right now. Here is a very interesting thing here in the short view. Yeah, they treated different methods, and they see that indeed the photothermal, because it doesn't open, it doesn't cut, it doesn't do anything, it doesn't spread anywhere else, and so on. And they did neurotoxicity for several months, and they measured chemical. So when you go to the doctor for a checkup once a year, all these examinations that the doctor give you, they did it every several months after the treatment. And they saw chemistry did not change. That means there is no effect of the treatment on the body medicine or body chemistry, you see. It's very, very important. So these are different chemicals, and it's a function of time and all these things, and that they had the methodology to measure everything and things like that. So there was no, and they have to do this, to take it to Zatisaha, to show them all the results that are there. And everything is okay. It's a very interesting case. Here's they're even discovering new methods of treatment of its surgery. Here's a, they found that if you take, this dog here had a huge one here spreading, and it was so big that to treat it by this method would take a long time. It would heal and go down a little bit, and some more injection and light would go down a little bit. It would take a long time. So what they did surgery first. They completely cut the lump out, throw it out, and then they photothermally sprayed the golden rods on the whole area there, and they exposed it to light, and that's completely cured it. More important, it did not come back. If you do surgery, a lot of the time the thing comes back. And this we're trying to understand on a molecular level too, it's very, very interesting. Yeah. You can see here they treated this part here by photothermal, they treated this day by surgery, and indeed, after a little bit, it came back, started coming back, and opens up my skin and everything. But if they do it and shine light on it, it will be really important. Afterwards, they found that indeed it does not work. So it's a new method of treatment. So this is some of the summary and conclusions. There is no evidence of long-term toxicity of golden rod in mice model, and golden rod, this method, is effective in treating natural memory gland tumors and all these names of glands used, and 13 months has been treated and the cure, and no signs of repair. More important, I think. I don't think it returned somewhere else in the body. If they do regular surgery, they found out that after a year or so, it starts appearing somewhere else. Cancer, that's normal. It appears somewhere, and that's what killed people. The secondary cancer that killed people, really. For the thermal method, they found it does not come again in any form, in anywhere in the body. So that itself is the thing that indeed is going to be quite important for them. Okay. Those are the people that did the work, and they spread the things on the cells and smaller things. And these are the people in Egypt with different groups that they do different things. For this, I'd like to thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Mustafa. Now it's time for the questions. So let's start.
Yes, or just
thank you very much. Very good question. I'm sorry I missed that.
you want to get light that goes into the body. Near infrared light is the light that you use. Near infrared light, you need to take to absorb it. To heat, the shape of the nanoparticle has to be in a round shape. Sphere will not absorb near infrared light. And we use near infrared light to go inside the body to where the cancer is. Very good question. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any more questions?
Thank you so much, Prof. I have two questions, please. The first one, you injected these particles as an uncoated or coated particles first. The second question, what is the beyond mechanism of lobbing the gold nanoparticles to the cancer cells over the normal cells?
What happens afterwards?
Again?
The
second question.
Uh-huh.
Why these gold nanoparticles lob the cancer cells? Because you said that these particles go in the surface of cancer over the normal cells.
Yeah, it doesn't, the gold nanoparticle itself will not go and hold to cancer cells by itself or anything. What we depend on is that once you heat the nanorod in the media where cancer cells are, this media become hot. And then the cancer cell in the same medium, it get the heat itself will kill the cancer cell. In the beginning, we thought we had to bind it to the cancer cell itself in the beginning. And that's why we got all these, long chain things. But then we found out it doesn't make any difference. You can just as long as you heat the region itself, that's enough. Good question, thank you.
A female section, any question?
Yeah.
Okay,
thank you. Thank you, Professor Mustafa, for your interesting presentation. I'm Yeni Rishan from Brawijaya University, Indonesia. I would like to ask you a question about drug efficacy for cancer cells using a drug field microscope. Did you use a certain staining method for bioimage of cancer cell? For example, did you use antibody or something, other material labeling method for drug field microscope? Using living cell bioimaging to present a fluorescence image. Thank you.
Actually, you just looked. What we did, I had my son was a cancer doctor himself, and all what we had to do was just to mix the solution, and then he took just one drop and put it on a shirehtil, this glass thing for the microscopes, and just looked in the microscope itself directly. Just make an image of that. You can take a picture of that. Also, the microscope itself can give you a picture of that if you like. Yeah. It's okay.
I guess.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
Any more questions from your side, female?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes.
Please.
Thank you, Dr. Mustafa, for your lecture today. I want to ask about the gold nanoparticles. Has it confirmed to be a way of treatment of cancer on a human? And is there any side effects of that method?
Yeah, in human, we did not get to. That's why we hope to, by doing all these animal experiments and going from one animal to the other, we actually cured the cancer on the back of a horse the other day. The more animals you do, the more proof, you make it easier for Wizard al-Sahha to approve it, you see. That's what they, and we have to have with us medical doctors in cancer, medical doctors themselves with us, actually in these experiments, always with us. cancer doctors, and they are the ones to write to the Minister of Health what have they seen and what is it good or bad or whatever. And the cancer doctors in Egypt are the ones that definitely have to write the final reports of what they have seen. And because they do not take our word, because they have somebody that understand cancer itself. Yeah. Thank you.
Any question? Okay, go on.
Yes?
No, just a second.
Thanks a lot for your presentation, Dr. Mustafa. And we acknowledge your effort to treat cancer. On behalf of the cat and the kitten, we acknowledge your effort to treat this cat. And I'd like to ask about what is the metabolism of gold nanoparticle? It's easy to extract from the body of
human cells. Very good question. Where does it go? Where does gold nanoparticle? It does not come out, that is for sure. But we had some pictures of the spleen and the liver. They are the cleaning organs. Everything goes through there to clean up. And indeed, it goes there. I'm sorry I did not have this thing, but the liver is huge. And this nanoparticle that did this thing is a very, very small amount. And it doesn't really change very much. Over 15 months period, it went down a little bit in the amounts, but not that much. But more important, it did not do any damage to the liver itself. The size of the liver never changed. The size of the spleen never changed. But that's very, very important, of course. And that's what they look at. And they wait the longer, we want to do it longer and longer, so it shows that these organs does not get changed over the period of time, over lifetime remaining of the patient probably. Yeah. But that's very important. Yeah. Thank you.
Any more questions from this side? Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you, Professor Mustafa. Did you study the activity of nanoparticles with elements other than gold?
Over?
Other than gold, other elements.
Yeah, we are studying this with elements, yeah. All these experiments that we are doing now, animals are the ones that we deal with. We don't, did I get your question right?
No.
Other metals than gold.
Oh, very good question, yeah, sorry. Silver is no good, unfortunately, but it is good for other things. I mean, if you want to kill something, it will kill it. So they use silver to kill certain insects or certain things that you don't want. And we found that also is not good for normal cells that we have. Yeah. It gets some kind of oxides, I think, silver oxide and all kinds of chemistry that takes over, much more active. Gold and nanoparticles sometimes not active in the body. Yeah. Good question. Thank you.
Female section. Any question?
Yes. Thank you, Prof, for this amazing lecture. But I want to ask, how did you prepare the drug or synthesize it? You already talked about the technique, about how the drug interacts with the cancer cells. But how did you prepare this drug?
How you make the gold nanoparticles fairly easy. You reduce gold salts essentially, but a certain way, and not a very fancy way. But then you have in the solution a chemical that binds to the surface of the gold nanoparticle, and by adjusting the concentration of this chemical to the concentration of the gold amount itself, and as the gold nanoparticle grows, it starts getting bind around it, this binding gap, organic compound, and once you have adjusted concentration right, it can get enough of it that no more gold can be deposited on the one that you already have. so it stops growing. So just adjusting the concentration of the thing on the vine that put on the outside surface with respect to the cold iron itself, and that gives you the size you want. The smaller amount of this solution of the that binds on the outside, the larger the cold nanoparticle becomes. Right. Good question. Good question. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Let's take the last question.
Sorry, but I have another question.
Okay.
No, just a second. A question from our side.
Okay. Thank you very much, our respected Professor Said. I just have one question about selectivity of a gold nano route for treatment of different tumor cells. There are many tumors, like for example, stomach, colon, or brain. If there are any selectivity for gold nano route for that, thank you very much.
You mean do they bind specifically to something or the other?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, no. It really. We just try to. If you want to specifically want to bind them to the cell, to the cancer cell, you bind this molecule I showed you in one of the slides, the early slides. And this molecule binds on one side to the gold nanoparticle, and on the other side, it has a functional group that binds to the surface covering of the cell itself. But we found out that we really didn't even need that. We don't need that. If you have enough of each one of them, you have the heat itself will do it. Yeah.
You said the last question from the male section, but the female will still have one more. Okay, go ahead. Ani.
Prof, you said that silver has some toxicity, so it will be not useful for this treatment?
I'm sorry, the gold or the silver? Oh, the silver, yes. Silver is we found that it does kill the cells. It does kill the cells. And that's why we stopped it. But of course, if you want to kill bacteria or something, silver is wonderful. And I used it for years, actually. And but for some reason, we found that it kills the cells that we have, and we stopped using it immediately. Yeah, yeah.
Either as a nanoparticle.
Pardon me. Sorry.
Either as a silver nanoparticles also.
Silver nanoparticle, yeah. Silver nanoparticle, the nanoparticle itself also does damage, yes. Right.
Thank you very much, Professor Mustafa. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.
Now, Professor Hamid.